Welcome to Fix It Home Improvement, covering projects that every homeowner should know and great products for home and garden.
Hi, I'm JC, and this is where we share weekly home improvement tips. I'm here with my co-host, Cindy.
Hello, JC.
Hi, Cindy. This week, we're going to be talking about sleeping bags, and we'd like to thank Ixhale for liking and sharing the podcast, and we'd like to thank everybody who's been commenting on our last ebook. There's been some good comments.
That's nice.
And our eighth ebook, Home Improvement Solutions, What Every Homeowner Should Know, will be coming out in July on Amazon. One of the first patents for a sleeping bag was in 1876 and was sold around the world through mail order. It looked like a big rug that you folded over on yourself. Eddie Bauer had a patent in 1944 for a sleeping bag, and he designed one of the first down coats for the Air Force in the 1940s. We stopped by Dick's and Bass Pro Shops to see how the sleeping bags are displayed and the selection they have.
He took me on a field trip this week.
And that Bass Pro Shop is pretty impressive. The one by us is 140,000 square feet. It has a 20,000 gallon aquarium, a restaurant, a fudge shop. That's fantastic. And an archery.
You didn't take me there.
And an archery range. At the two stores we went to, they primarily had rectangular and mummy sleeping bags. Rectangular bags have more room to move around, so they're great for people who turn a lot while they sleep or change positions from stretched out to curled up. They usually don't have a hood, so they're not going to be as warm as a mummy style.
Okay.
A rectangular bag is good for warm or mild conditions. You can unzip it to cool off if you get warm and use it like a blanket. They're usually heavier and bulkier than other styles, so they're good for car or RV camping where weight wouldn't be an issue and you want comfort. In your home, they can make a handy extra bed for guests with a pad.
Here, enjoy our floor. Sleep on this bag.
Here's our guest bag. A mummy-style sleeping bag has an integrated hood and it's more form-fitting, so the shape kind of looks like an ancient Egyptian sarcophagus. And that form-fitting design helps retain body heat, so they're better for camping in cold conditions. They're wider through the shoulders, and then they taper down towards your feet.
Exciting.
Most mummy bags are lightweight and designed to pack down to a small size for backpacking.
Do you love saying mummy bag?
I do, and sarcophagus. There are styles called semi-rectangular, barrel-shaped, or pod. These are wider than a mummy style to provide more room to move around.
Because a mummy style is pretty form-fitting.
Yeah, a lot of people complain that it's difficult, especially if you're not used to just sleeping on your back.
Right.
It's a little uncomfortable because it's kind of wrapped around you. It's hard to turn from side to side.
And you might have a hard time getting comfortable on the ground.
Right. Well, we'll talk about pads. You'll have a very comfortable pad, which you should have for your guest bed in your home. So some of these wider styles come with a hood, some don't. They'll have an enclosed area around your feet called a foot box, like a mummy bag, and that increases the warmth. So these styles are good for cool weather camping. There are double-wide sleeping bags, and these are like giant rectangular bags, so multiple people can sleep in it. Some rectangular bags are designed to zip into another rectangular bag to make a double-wide bag. But you have to have compatible zippers and the length and zipper locations. So you need to check the labels if you want that option. You can get kid-sized sleeping bags that are smaller. There's woman sleeping bags, usually wider at the hips. Some will have additional insulation at the foot box and the middle of the bag. And then there's elephant foot sleeping bags that are kind of two-thirds of a sleeping bag. These are designed to cover you from the chest down. They're ultra lightweight for backpacking. You'd keep your upper body and your head warm by wearing your winter jacket and your hood, and the bag is covering your torso and legs. They taper down like a mummy bag.
Weird.
You know, in the 14 and 1500s, Europeans would grind up ancient Egyptian mummies and use it as medicine. So they believed that mummies were embalmed using bitumen, and according to Pliny the Elder, the ancient historian, bitumen and wine would cure coughs, help treat cataracts, toothaches, and skin disease.
I can't believe they didn't live longer.
Some of the oldest and most well-known mummies are the Egyptian mummies, some of them dating back to around 3500 BC. But the Aztecs, the Incan, Australian, and European civilizations also practiced mummification. And it was usually only for the rich because of the cost of the material, the workers, and time. Experts think Egyptian mummification took about 70 days. Cryonics is kind of the modern mummification. And it's also just for the rich. When you're comparing sleeping bags, look at the recommended heights. Most bags come standard or regular for people up to 6 feet tall and long for people up to 6 foot, 6 inches tall. Some of the woman's bags come in regular for up to 5 foot, 4 inches tall and long for 5 foot, 10 inches. Although I saw a couple that were labeled 5 foot, 8 inches. So check the labels when you're comparing. The shoulder and the hip girth might also be listed. Most of the men's bags ranged from 60 to 64 inches. The women's bags, 56 to 60 inches for the shoulder girth. And the hip range was around 58 to 60 inches. And when I spoke to Bass Pro Shops, they said to try them out before you buy them. And REI also let you try them out. And I don't know why we didn't jump into a couple when we were at Bass Pro Shops.
I could tell you why.
I spoke to Mountain Equipment, and they said one of the most important things to compare when you're shopping for a sleeping bag is the temperature rating. If you plan on using the bag in cold weather, purchase a bag based on the lowest nighttime temperature because you can unzip the bag for warmer weather, or you can get a bag with vents. Mountain Equipment said the EN13537 test is the most widely used test for sleeping bags, and this determines the temperature rating. And it's a test done by third-party labs, so you can compare bags from different companies, and it's based on the same testing and standards. There's a new criteria called ISO 23587, and ISO is the International Organization for Standardization. This is a new organization that oversees sleeping bag testing. Many labels will be marked EN/ISO and have a temperature range. If it just has an EN number or an ISO number, the testing is almost identical, so that way you can compare the numbers from different companies. Some will have a label that shows two numbers, a higher number called the comfort rating, and this is what the average cold sleeper would find comfortable. Some brands call this the woman's rating. And a lower number, this is the lower limit rating. This is what the average warm sleeper would find comfortable. And some brands call this the men's rating. Some labels will have three numbers. And this is usually sleeping bags for serious backpackers or mountain climbers who will be out in very cold conditions. It'll be a comfort rating, a lower limit rating, and then an extreme limit rating. Or it'll be called comfort, transition, and extreme. But for basic campers, you're going to have just that comfort and lower limit rating. It's interesting how they do the EN-ISO test. They use a person-shaped heated mannequin with temperature sensors. They dress it in standard pajamas. The test is in a cold room with a slight breeze and a 1-inch thick sleeping pad under the sleeping bag. And that's how they determine the temperature ratings. That's pretty cool looking. And the numbers are a great way to compare similar bags, but your comfort's going to depend on the type of tent you're in, or if you're even in a tent, the sleeping pad and the type, your metabolism, your clothing, and how you fit inside the bag.
What happens when it's too tight?
If you're compressing the insulation, you'll have cold spots. So you want a little bit of airspace. In fact, the less airspace, the warmer the bag's going to be. Like the rectangular bags, if you just have too much airspace, it's not going to be as warm, much more comfortable to turn around in and move in. But more airspace, you just can't heat it up as easily. But if it's too tight, then you're going to have cold spots.
So it's like Goldilocks.
Exactly. Another rating on sleeping bags is the season rating. They're usually rated as summer, winter, or three season. And for serious backpackers or mountain climbers, they're going to have specialty bags and temperature ranges. Some companies will have a season 1, 2, 3, and 4. A season 1 would generally be for summer, 40 degrees Fahrenheit and warmer. season two for late spring or early fall, 32 degrees and warmer. Season three would be late fall from 23 to 32 degrees. And season four for winter around 14 to 23 degrees. Many companies will just have it listed as a summer bag rated for around 30 degrees Fahrenheit and higher, a three-season bag 15 degrees and higher, or a winter bag 15 degrees and lower. But if you plan on a winter bag, look at the lowest comfort temperature rating and match it to the coldest nighttime temperature you'd be using the bag in.
But you wouldn't want to get a winter bag for the summer.
Right, yeah, it could be way too warm. And especially depending on the type, like if you got a mummy type that's rated for very low temperatures and it's not vented very well, you're just going to be uncomfortable.
Okay.
Some bags will have the higher comfort rating with the female symbol and the lower rating with the male symbol. And those are the ancient symbols for Venus and Mars.
All right.
On the outside of the packaging, on most of the bags we saw, there was just one number. So we saw 0, 20, 30, 35, 40, and 50. And then it had a picture of the shape, like rectangular or mummy, and the dimensions. So 33 by 77, for example. And the weight. And the bags we saw, they range from 2 to 3 pounds. And a couple of the articles I read suggested adding 10 degrees for the rating on packaging if there's just one number, or if it's not an EN ISO rated bag. So for example, a 30 degree bag should be used in temperatures of 40 degrees or warmer.
Hmm.
Sleeping bags have two main types of insulation, down and synthetic. Down is the fine, fluffy feathers against the skin of a duck or a goose, and it's the insulating feathers. This is under the tough exterior feathers. Down is very lightweight, it's a great insulator, and it's much more compressible than most synthetics. Also more durable. It can be packed into a very small compression sack for backpacking, and then when you remove it, it just fluffs up. But for long-term storage, you'd want to store a down bag in a larger storage sack. Down will compress and expand many more times than most synthetics and not lose its insulating qualities. It's interesting, isn't it?
Exciting.
Down almost always has a higher warmth to weight ratio compared to synthetics. So a 30 degree Fahrenheit down will weigh less and compress smaller than a 30 degree Fahrenheit synthetic. The disadvantage is down is usually more expensive, and if it gets wet, it reduces its ability to retain heat. So if you're camping and you might get your gear wet regularly, down might not be the best choice. And when you're comparing down sleeping bags, look at the fill power, F-I-L-L. It's usually in the 400 to 900 range. And to measure the fill power, companies use 1 ounce of down. They put it into a standardized cylinder and then they compress it. They remove the weight and the down is measured after 72 hours to see how much it's expanded. And the height in cubic inches is the fill power. So an 800 fill power bag and a 600 fill power bag that are both rated at 20 degrees Fahrenheit, they're going to insulate the same. It just takes more 600 fill down to do the same job, so it's going to be heavier.
Interesting.
Yeah, wild. Down can be treated with a water repellent to make it more water resistant, so look for that label. Down bags marked with RDS certified, that's the responsible down standard. They use down from animals not subjected to unnecessary harm, and this is verified by a third-party company. There are a lot of different synthetic blends. Generally, they'll be heavier and pack thicker. Most are going to be less expensive than down and don't lose a lot of insulating qualities when they're wet. They dry out faster and they're easy to clean. Usually a better choice if there's a chance your bag is going to get wet, or if you're going to be camping in humid conditions, or if you get into your bags if you're wet or sweaty. And that's another thing with down. It'll absorb body oil, sweat, and dirt over time, and it reduces its ability to hold heat. So it's a good practice to change into clean clothes at night when you're getting into a down bag, or use a sleeping bag liner. And this will help protect your bag and the insulation. It also adds another layer of insulation. A couple articles I read said a bag liner can add 5 to 15 degrees of warmth. And then you can regularly wash that liner and it'll protect your bag.
Interesting.
Some sleeping bags will be marked left or right-hand zip. Left-hand zip for a right-handed person. Right-hand zip for a left-handed person. Bass Pro Shops gave us some tips. They said only buy a bag with a quality zipper and check it out at the store. Models designed to keep the bag material out of the way of the teeth will be less frustrating and protect the material. Zipper flaps that rest against the zipper will help retain heat. And self-healing zippers are pretty interesting. So if you accidentally kick the zipper apart at night, you can just unzip and then re-zip it and the teeth will snap back together.
Magical.
And a zip-in lining is a good feature. Loops at the end of the bag will let you hang it out to dry out or air out. A waterproof stuff sack is good protection for your bag.
What is that?
It's a waterproof sack that you stuff your bag into.
Thanks for clarifying.
A draft collar will keep you warmer. So this is a padded section around shoulder height that wraps around from the front to the back on the inside of the bag. And this helps keep air trapped inside the bag. So if you're rolling from side to side. Adjustable draw cords around your chest or in the hood of a mummy style is going to help keep you warmer. And storage pockets are a great feature for your wallet, a flashlight, or keys. But make sure you check the location for comfort. And a pocket for your phone will help keep your battery warmer and extend the battery life. The outer fabric is usually polyester or nylon. Make sure it has a durable water repellent. It's going to repel water but allow vapor inside the bag to pass through. The inner fabric can have a brushed texture for softness and comfort, but I would compare the materials and compare the warranty of the bags. Also the retailer if you're buying it in a store. If you're buying it online, check the return policy.
Okay.
A sleeping pad under your bag is going to add insulation and more comfort. The three main types are manually inflated, self-inflating, and closed cell foam. The manually inflated sleeping bags are lightweight for backpacking. You either blow them up or use a foot pump, and some have a built-in foot pump. Some of these also have heat-reflecting material, like a space blanket inside to reflect heat. They're rated comfortable, but they can be punctured, so you should have a repair kit. Closed cell foam pads are usually thin. They can be rolled up or folded. Some have reflective material for more warmth. They don't have as much cushion as manually inflated or self-inflating. Self-inflating pads have open cell foam insulation and air pockets to create a very comfortable insulated pad. You open an air valve and roll out the pad. The foam expands and it draws air into the pad. You can also blow into the valve to add more air pressure for firmer support. These are good for car camping. You can get thick, wide pads for more comfort. You want to match the pad size to your sleeping bag. And some sleeping bags will have sleeves to hold the pad in place, so you want to match that size. I saw pads with an R value of anywhere between 1 and 11. The higher the number, the warmer they're going to keep you. When you're done camping, hang your bag and let it air out. Make sure it's completely dry. If your bag's dirty, you can spot clean small areas.
Can you wash it?
Yeah, most sleeping bags can be machine washed. I would follow the recommendations on the label. Usually it's on the gentle cycle with very little detergent, or they may recommend a specific cleaner. Most can be dried on the lowest heat setting in a dryer, but double check that. With down, you should add a tennis ball or two to fluff up the down.
So weird.
It needs to be completely dry before you store it. Use a mesh storage bag and store it in a cool, dry location. You can apply a durable water repellent on the outside fabric when it stops repelling water. I would check the recommended application for your product. Nikwax, it's N-I-K-W-A-X, has some highly rated products for sleeping bags.
Okay.
Some top-rated sleeping bags are from Big Agnes, it's B-I-G, capital A-G-N-E-S, Cabela's, C-A-B-E-L-A-S, R-E-I, it's just the letters R, E, and I, Bass Pro Shops, Marmot, it's M-A-R-M-O-T-T, Mountain Equipment, Kelty, K-E-L-T-Y, North Face, Nemo, N-E-M-O, and Teton, T-E, T-O-N.
Do you have anything else to add?
If you plan on backpacking, you're looking for lightweight and compressible. Down is going to be hard to beat. For cold weather camping, a mummy bag or a barrel style with a hood is probably going to be the warmest. If you're car or RV camping, generally rectangular bags are rated the most comfortable. You want to match the low temperature of the bag to the lowest nighttime temperature and use a sleeping pad for comfort, insulation, and it's going to help protect your bag.
Let's wrap this up.
You can subscribe to our podcast on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, CastBox, Himalaya, or your favorite podcast app.
If you enjoyed it, please leave us a review.
You can check out our home improvement videos on our YouTube channel, Fix It Home Improvement.
And you can subscribe to that as well.
You can download our ebooks, Home Improvement Solutions, What Every Homeowner Should Know, Books 1 through 7 on Amazon.
If you enjoyed it, please leave us a 5-star rating and review.
You can email us at fixitpodcast@gmail.com. You can follow Cindy on Twitter at fixitcohost. And you can follow us on Instagram, Fix It Home Improvement.
Thank you for listening.
Talk to you next week. Do